PhD job is a clinical geneticist. So I think we're going to take a step back from Professor Whitler's presentation now and go to the step before, as I hopefully can tell you a wee bit about the genetics of spina bifida and hydrocephalus. So first of all, we need to find out what a gene is, and many of you will have seen photographs and pictures on television of DNA, which is what our genes are made of. And DNA is a chemical molecule that's twisted round. There's two strands of it into a double helix. And I know that some of you were with me in Strasbourg at an IF workshop at the end of last year, and I happened to notice that their staircases were modelled on DNA, and they also were a double helix, which intrigued me, but probably other people didn't notice at the time. So what is a gene? Well, it's basically a recipe for the production of proteins and the formation of the body as it develops in very early development, like Professor Mutler's just been telling us. And also, our genes tell us how to function as we go throughout life. So some genes can become inactive before we're born, and other genes can become faulty or inactive as we go throughout life. And our genes are packaged into things called chromosomes, which occur in almost every cell in the body. And when the scientists in the laboratory look down the microscopes, this is what chromosomes look like. But fortunately for us, somebody sits and cuts them out of that photograph and arranges them into neat pairs like this. And a very clever artist a few years ago looked at this picture of chromosomes that the scientists produced, and he thought that they looked like pairs of socks. And I think you agree that these stripy socks illustrate the chromosomes very well. And what you can see from this slide is that we have 46 chromosomes, and they all occur as pairs. Now, these socks or chromosomes are chromosomes from a female, and all our socks are the same apart from this final pair here, and females have a nice, neat matching pair, whereas, as you might expect, males don't have socks that match as their final pair. And the reason that our chromosomes or socks come in pairs is that we get one sock from our mothers and the other sock from our fathers. And when we have children, we just pass on one of each pair of our socks to our children. Now, I told you earlier that genes are a recipe, and you might have heard of the genetic code. Now, this genetic code is made up of these chemicals along the DNA chemical molecule. It's the initial letters of these chemicals, and they all get transferred into the recipe. And each of the words in the recipe only has three letters, so G, T, C is the first word, A, C, A is the second word, and so on, until all the words tell the body how it makes its proteins and chemicals. Now, last year when I spoke in Stockholm, I thought it was good to compare our genes, our recipes, to the recipe for making a cake. And here you see the usual recipe for making a sponge cake. And if you follow this recipe, you get a nice cake like this. But if there was a spelling mistake in the recipe, there's not enough flour in this recipe, then this might happen to your cake, and you don't get such a good cake. But you could get a cake like this as well if it wasn't a mistake in the recipe, if the oven wasn't at the right temperature, or if somebody opened the oven door while your cake was baking. So it's not always a mistake in the recipe that causes things to go wrong. Now, here we have the genetic recipe for a perfect baby. All these words again are going to tell us how the baby's to be made. But I've translated it for you, and this is really the recipe for a perfect baby. So if you follow this recipe, you end up with something like this. But unfortunately, if we take 1,000 couples who are having a baby, we find that 1 out of 1,000 of these couples will have a baby that looks a bit more like this one. Now, was that due to a spelling mistake in the recipe, or was it something else? And that's what we have to try and find out. And if we look at this one in 1,000 people again, the reason that we know that it's probably due to a mistake in the recipe at some point is once a lady has had a baby with spina bifida, instead of that 1 in 1,000 chance that the population had, her chance of having another child with the same condition is 1 in 25. So that tells us that that lady probably has some sort of mistake in the recipe when she's making babies. If the lady goes on and she has 2 children with spina bifida, then the chance of it happening again in a 3rd pregnancy gets even higher, and it would be 1 chance in 10. Now, for people who have spina bifida themselves, rather than the parents of a baby with spina bifida, we think that the same figures apply, that if you've got spina bifida yourself, your chance of having a baby with spina bifida is 1 chance in 25. That's also 4%. So if I turn it round the other way, it means 96% of the time people with spina bifida have babies that don't have spina bifida. So it's much more likely that they'll have healthy babies. In genetics clinics, the first thing that we do is we draw a family tree. And what we see here is the males in the family are squares and the females are circles. And if there is a medical problem or condition running in the family, we colour in the people who have the medical condition. And here in this family, you can see 3 different generations of the family have all had individuals with the medical condition. And both males and females are affected. And that tells us it's just one single gene that's responsible for causing that medical condition, and it's being passed down from parent to child. Here we see another family tree, and in this situation, there's a male and a female both affected, but they're only in 1 generation of the family. And again, that tells us it's likely to be a spelling mistake in a single gene that's causing the medical condition. But when we draw the family tree of a family who have a child with spina bifida, it usually looks like this. And by far the majority of families, only one individual in the family has spina bifida. Sometimes we see this, where there's another person with spina bifida in the family, but they're quite distantly removed from the first person that we saw in the clinic. And this is the typical pattern of inheritance that we see when a condition is what we call multifactorial. Now that means that both genetic factors and non-genetic factors are involved. And some people in the population, will have the genetic factors that make them susceptible to having a baby with spina bifida, and some pregnancies will be exposed to the non-genetic factors that can contribute to spina bifida. But it's only this group in the middle where they both have the genetic factors that make them susceptible and get exposed to the non-genetic factors that spina bifida actually happens. And what are the genetic factors? Well, I think you already saw my slide. We don't really know at the moment. We can look for clues to try and find these genetic factors. But if we go back to my original recipe for making a perfect baby, what we know about multifactorial inheritance is that it's not just a single spelling mistake in one gene, or we would just see it being passed down through different generations of a family. What we know from multifactorial inheritance is that there are several different spelling mistakes in several different genes. So there's more than one recipe goes wrong when a child is born with spina bifida. And the difficulty in trying to find the genetic factors is the spelling mistakes in that recipe book. The book gets closed, so we don't know what page the spelling mistakes are on. And to make matters worse, someone's put the book back on the shelf and we don't know which book the spelling mistakes are. So it's very difficult to try and find these genetic factors that are causing spina bifida. We can get some clues as to what the genetic factors might be if we found a family like this with spina bifida where it has occurred in 3 generations of a family. Then that would lead us to a gene that's very important for spina bifida occurring. But families like this are very rare, and researchers are constantly looking out for families like this to try and unravel the genes that cause spina bifida. We can also look at mouse models, and here we have this mouse has spina bifida, this is how it's affected his spine, and this is his sibling, who doesn't have spina bifida. You can see the difference in the tail. But so far, the research looking at mice that have spina bifida, or by changing the recipe in mouse genes to make them have spina bifida, has not led to us finding the genes in humans. Now, the non-genetic factors are a bit easier to work out, and some of these might help us find out what the genetic factors are. We know that in populations where nutrition is a problem, where people are undernourished, then spina bifida is more common. So that tells us that dietary factors might be important. We know that ladies who have some illnesses, such as diabetes, are more likely to have babies with spina bifida. And recent research has shown that at the other end of the scale, ladies who are very overweight when they become pregnant have a higher risk of having babies with spina bifida. And this group down here is, unfortunately, some ladies, particularly those who have epilepsy, have to take medication to control their epilepsy during pregnancy. And some of these medicines, because they interfere with folic acid, can increase the chance of having a baby with spina bifida. And this was partly what led us on to finding out that folic acid might contribute to spina bifida occurring. So what is the folic acid story? Well, I've already said that dietary factors have been recognised for many, many years as being a risk factor for spina bifida occurring. And we know that folic acid, we heard in Professor Mugler's talk that folic acid is important for DNA being produced, and then the recipes from the DNA producing these proteins that we need to form the body and for the body to function. So that's a clue that folic acid might be contributing. In 1991, people wanted to find out for definite if folic acid was involved in spina bifida occurring. And what they did is they took ladies who'd already had a baby with spina bifida, and we knew that they had that 1 in 25, the increased chance of having a second baby, and they divided them into four groups. One group had folic acid before they became pregnant for 3 months, and then for the first 3 months of their pregnancy. Another group had folic acid plus some other vitamins. One group had just the other vitamins, and the fourth group didn't have folic acid or any type of vitamin at all. And when they looked at all these babies, when they had their next baby, here's what folic acid does, way down here, we saw this already. They found that the ladies that had this 1 in 25 risk, or if we turn that round another way, as I said, that's 4 ladies out of 100 ladies, if they took the folic acid, they could reduce that to just 1 lady in 100. So it was reduced by about 60 to 70% in this study, and that's what told us that folic acid was very important by taking it to prevent spina bifida occurring. It must be taken before a lady becomes pregnant, and that's often a problem because not all pregnancies are planned. And the reason for this is the folic acid level needs to be at a high enough level in the bloodstream to prevent the spina bifida occurring. Because of that study, it's now recommended that ladies, even if they've not already had a baby with spina bifida, should take folic acid prior to becoming pregnant. But they take it at a slightly lower dose than that that's recommended for ladies who have already had a baby with spina bifida, or for ladies who have spina bifida themselves. And again, we saw this pathway earlier. Folic acid is the first chemical that works on folic acid after it's taken into the body is this 5-10-methylene tetrahydrofolate reductase, or MTHFR. And we thought it might be useful to look to see if there were any spelling mistakes in the recipe that makes this chemical. And we found that ladies who had babies with spina bifida were more likely to have a spelling mistake in this gene than the general population. But it still occurs in ladies who don't have babies with spina bifida, so it's not the full answer to the story. And that's led researchers to look at other chemicals that might be important in contributing to spina bifida. Inositol is a carbohydrate, and again, it's required for the way that DNA functions, so it could well be involved in causing spina bifida. And again, in London, they are carrying out a study similar to the folic acid one, to see if ladies who have already had a baby with spina bifida, if the chance of it happening again can be reduced further by taking inositol in addition to folic acid. Vitamin B12, there are some reports from both Ireland and Canada that have looked at vitamin B12, another of the vitamins important for cells being formed. And they found that ladies who had babies with spina bifida had lower levels of vitamin B12, and it therefore looks likely that this might be another contributing factor. And some places, we know that in the UK, the Association for Spina Bifida, SHINE, are supporting this and suggesting that ladies should take vitamin B12 in addition to folic acid when they're trying to conceive a pregnancy. So in the future, are we going to know all about what causes spina bifida? Well, the next step is this thing called exome sequencing. Now, this is just a very clever computer program that can look at all our recipes for spelling mistakes. And the plan is that they're going to work their way through the whole library of books to find out spelling mistakes that occur more commonly in babies that have spina bifida than babies who do not have spina bifida. But it's likely that it's not going to be the same recipes in each individual who has spina bifida, and it's going to remain very complicated, and we're not going to get an easy answer. So I hope that might have made things a little bit clearer, but I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Do we have any questions? Yes. Can we have the microphone there, please?
Hello. Can you do something more than just taking folic acid, like when you do in vitro fertilization or something?
Sorry, what was the bit before the in vitro fertilization?
Can you do something more than just take folic acid, like when you do in vitro fertilization? Can you select embryos or, I don't know?
No, the thing that you are talking about is a thing called pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. We can do that when a medical condition is caused by one single gene. But unfortunately, because spina bifida is not due to just one single gene, then we can't do anything with in vitro. So folic acid is the only thing that we know for definite at the moment reduces the risk. But as I said, vitamin B12 doesn't do any harm. So if a lady wants to really reduce her risk as much as possible, it might be worth taking vitamin B12 as well.
FMF genetik bir rahatsızlık olduğunu söylüyorlar.
Hadi
family Mediterranean fair.
Okay.
Mediterranean fair. Yes. Evet. Bir de spina bifida ameliyatı olmuşum bir haftalıkken. Spina bir haftalıkken. Onun da genetik olduğunu, yani spina bifidanın genetik olduğunu şu anda öğrendim.
It's partly genetic.
Sadece kısmen genetik bir
kısmen. İkisinin bir bağlantısı var mı?
They're not connected.
Bağlantı
bir bağlantıları
değil.
Yok. the FMF.
FMF?
Yes.
Is due to one single spelling mistake. And spina bifida is lots of different spelling mistakes.
FMF denilen rahatsızlık sadece bir sıkıntı, bir yanlıştan kaynaklanıyor kodlamada. Spina bifida birçok sıkıntının bir araya gelmesiyle oluşan bir şey.
They're not connected.
Ve birbirleriyle bağlantılı değiller.
Yes. Şimdi benim nereden, yani ailemin, atalarımın geldiğini soruyorlar. Kırım Türklerinden aslında. Bunun bir etkisi olduğunu söylüyorlar.
Bir saniye bekleyin. Çevirmen alabiliyormuş. Siz normal konuşabilirsiniz. Kulaklıktan çeviriyi dinleyecekler.
Where your ancestors come from makes a difference to the chance of you having FMF. But not spina bifida.
Etkin. Thank you.
Teşekkürler. Another question here. Enis.
Normal spina bifidanın oluşmaması için folik asit kullanımı ve B12 kullanımı yeterli. Fakat diyelim ki spina bifidalı birisi evlendi, hem de spina bifidalı biriyle evlendi. Bu durumda ek bir şey yapmak lazım mı spina bifidanın önlenmesi? Çünkü risk daha da yükseliyor, ifade ettiğiniz gibi 25'te 1'e kadar çıkıyor.
Spina bifida have a baby together, the risk would be higher, but the way of reducing the risk is folic acid, whether it's one parent or both parents that have spina bifida. We don't have an exact figure for what the risk would be, because there are not enough couples where both parents have spina bifida who have had babies for us to know. But the risk, the overall risk would still be low, and it would be far more likely that you would have a baby that does not have spina bifida.
Teşekkür.
Teşekkürler. Any more questions? Right, then may I have, oh sorry, another question.
Spina bifidalı kardeşlerin evliliğindeki risk nedir acaba?
If siblings.
Evet, kardeşlerin evliliğinde.
Well, in my country it's illegal for...
Hayır hayır.
Cousins.
Spina bifidalı kardeşler, yani kardeş çocukları, kuzenler.
Cousins. It would be the same as not being related with regard to spina bifida. But they would also have a risk of having babies with other genetic conditions if they're quite closely related. But the spina bifida wouldn't be any higher than if you were not related.
Teşekkür ederim.
Okay, we have one more question.